You know, there's a song, Medina, Medina.
Yes.
Medina, Medina. Anyway, Medina, that's a long story, doctor. That's a long story, Jayed. So I finished my matric while I was still studying in my Hifz school, etc., etc.
Mm-hmm.
The madrasa that I went to, I mean, I don't want to go down, you know, but this is the reality. You want my story? This is my story.
Yes,
the
madrasa we want to hear your story.
The madrasa I studied at is, we would say, a traditional, in South African terms, it's a traditional Sunni Barelvi type of madrasa.
Okay.
That's the outlook and the background that they, the tradition that they come from. My family, etc., we are more on the Diobandi Tablighi side of matters. And so I was in this madrasa here. And while I was growing up, there were certain things that happened. I remember once one of the brothers in the local community, he mentioned to somebody, you know, so-and-so went for Hajj, but he was not praying behind the imam, and somebody was like hassling him. So I was in my high school. I asked him, what do you mean somebody was not praying behind the imam? He says, no, you can't pray behind the imam. I said, what do you mean you can't pray? Go to Makkah, you can't pray behind the imam. He says, no, they are Wahhabis. I said, what's a Wahhabi? I'm talking about, I'm 14, 15 years old. I don't know all of these. If Wahhabi is like a fish in Mauritius or something, right? And so he says, no, do the khatam, you know, when somebody dies and you have the 40-day khatam and stuff. So I said, no, I don't do that. He says, when the Prophet ﷺ's name is mentioned in the adhan, do you kiss and rub your eyes and with your thumbs? I said, no, I don't do that. You do the maulid. I said, no, I don't know. I don't think we do that. So he said, well, you are Wahhabi and I can't pray behind you. And so I was like, oh, okay. I mean, I'll have jayid khair, inshallah. Right? And then every year for Ramadan, my ustad, who, alhamdulillah, he had, you know, I would say like the best of both worlds. Or he was exposed to the Barelvi side of matters and also the Tablighi Diobandi side of matters. He came from a traditional Barelvi family, but when he went to India, he studied and he mixed with many of the Diobandi. So he was like, you know, a mix, mashallah. And even the previous madrasa that he taught at, it was a Diobandi Tablighi madrasa Darul Ulum. So he was, you know, cool, I would say, with matters. But every year, he would obviously choose us, Bilal, you going to this masjid for Taraweeh, Bilal, you going there, Ahmed, you going there, Salman, you going here, there, and everywhere, right? And so one year for Taraweeh, I'm in my high school, probably about maybe 15, 16 years old, I guess. So the masjid that I would usually go to every year, on the first night of Taraweeh, one of the other Hufaz, he doesn't pitch up. And so we're like, where's this guy? What happened to him? We go home, phone him up and stuff like this. Sheikh, where are you? Why didn't you come for Taraweeh? I mean, you know, generally for Taraweeh, you prepare your stuff better than you would prepare for the next man. And so now we had to cover for this guy. And so we phone him up. He says, no, I was there and I was supposed to make Taraweeh. But then the Mawlana said, you know what, brother, I told you, you can pray here. I'm talking now, Sheikh, you know, maybe the reality on the ground is not, it has changed. I hope, inshallah, that the reality has changed. But I'm talking now, you're asking a story. This is like 20 years ago type of story. 20, 25 years ago, things were a bit more tight and tougher. So he says that the Mawlana said to him that, brother, you know what? You make salah at the Diobandi Tablighi Masjid. And my musalli is here. They will not pray behind you. And so you, as a hafiz of Quran, we cannot allow you here any longer. So that's why I went back home. That's what he says. I said, oh, okay. I mean, that's okay. Jayid khair. The next night for Taraweeh, they said to us, you know what? We're getting a replacement. The next night, replacement. The next night, replacement. The next night, no replacement is coming. And so myself, naive, I stood up one Friday after Taraweeh and I said to the jama'ah, I said, brothers, you know what? We are guests here. We come here to make Taraweeh here. We've never had any issues, any problems. But there was somebody else who was supposed to be here, but he is not here any longer because you guys don't want to pray behind him because he makes Jumu'ah at the Diobandi Masjid. Today, Jumu'ah, I was there at that masjid. I was at the Tablighi Masjid. So I don't know whether I will be allowed here any longer. We need to sort out this mushkila, this problem. And so obviously all hell broke loose in that masjid, and we were there in the classroom, and the Mawlana is I'm a shikr rasul and I will kill and spill blood, but I will never pray behind the Diobandi Tablighi, etc. Ya Allah, long story short, eventually they said, okay, you know what, call that hafizah back and let him pray. As if he's already found another masjid. They said, well, then you read 10 and the next guy must read 10. And so, khalas, we started reading 10. Issue was solved. We couldn't say anything because they said, call him back. few days later, that previous brother, who said we can't pray behind somebody in Makkah, he gets his gang together and they come to the masjid because they heard that there was some ruckus and there were some issues here. And they come and they say, we want this Bilal out of here. Why? Well, what happened? What's the story? No, because he is a Wahhabi, etc. And he's this and he's that. And he doesn't believe in the Miraj of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah only knows where they got that story from. Anyway, so the trustees, 1-2 days, the next day, they call me and they say, Hamisa, we thank you. You know, may Allah bless you all the services all these years. But we don't need your services anymore. Jazakallah khair. I said, so must I not make Taraweeh tonight? No, we don't need you. Can I still come to the masjid? Yes, you can, but you don't make Taraweeh. MashaAllah. So those guys told them, we'll get you a replacement. 4, 5, 7 nights went. There's no replacement coming. They got three guys to take my place there who were not even Hufaz of the Noble Quran. They knew nothing, unfortunately. And so the trustees realized that, they're not going to make a khatam of the Quran this Ramadan. And then I'm hearing, okay, they call me in the wudu khana again in front of all the musallis. I am a 15-year-old kid. I don't know about all of these matters, etc. When my father heard about it, he's not the most practicing of people, etc. He's like, I don't need all of this in my life, etc. Right? Anyway, so I'm dealing with all of this here. Then they tell me, come back after 5 days. So I said, brothers, the other guy, you kicked him out. Then you want me to come, then you said call him back. Then me, you kicked me out. Now you want to call me back. You haven't even ascertained whether it's true, these claims, assumptions, whatever people have said. How do you just do these crazy stuff like this here? Eventually, my friends and they said, no, please, Bilal, go back. So we went back and we made the khatam of the Quran, walhamdulillah. But this incident here sparked within me that why these issues? In South Africa, all are Hanafi here. In Durban, my areas, I am, etc. Both these groups are Hanafi. Both of them come from the Indian subcontinent. We won't even say Indian subcontinent. Both come from India, not even Pakistan. It was long before Pakistan, right? Come from India. But why this issue? Why this animosity? Why the problem? Both tie their hands below the navels, etc. But what? Both are Hanafis, Jayid. So where's the issue? What's the problem? So I spent hours and hours and hours and hours and hours, and I still have that Mus'haf, with all of my trying to research, what is this Hazir and Nazir? What is this matter of the Mawlid? What is the matter of the Ilmul Ghaib related to the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Is he everywhere? Does he know everything, etc.? Is he human being? Was he created from light, etc.? Those common issues between our Tablighi Diobandi brothers and the Brelvi Sunni brothers, I was looking up all of those matters. And so this sparked within me the desire to find out more. Find out what is the issue. Why? And so eventually, by the time I finished high school and stuff like this here, I then met somebody else. He met my cousin. He was from America. And he started to send us some books from there. And Bilal Phillips, Abu Amina Bilal Phillips, audio tapes, and Sheikh Ali Tamimi, etc. And so I began to ask, so what's the evidence? And who is this? And why? And how? And what's the difference? And all of these questions. And then I decided, I need to go and study. And alhamdulillah, I went to Medina. This is the abridged version. I went to Medina, did the interview, never heard from them again, which is the norm. The guy probably took your application form, one would have thought, and he ate his samosa and threw it in the bin or something like that. But alhamdulillah, 1 year later, I heard that these guys are back in South Africa. They're doing interviews. I go for another interview. I say to him that, I was there last year. I went personally. I did an interview. Alhamdulillah, I met up with Sheikh Tawfiq Chaudhry and Sheikh Yasir Qadi there, who assisted in matters. And we did the interview, and now we're waiting. He says, oh, okay, what's your name? He goes through a list there. I'm sitting to do a new interview. He says, brother, you've been accepted. Get your passport ready. And the rest is history.
Subhanallah.